just welcome to my talk today. It's on risk and failure and how that interfaces sort of with our SAU sort of coalition against human trafficking. I'll just start by giving you guys a little bit of a background. Sometimes I assume that people know different things about sort of the work that we've done, but I know sort of a lot of you maybe that are freshmen, sophomores, maybe some of you that are juniors may not be as familiar with what we've sort of the work that we've been doing. And I want to sort of talk a little bit about how risk and failure plays into that, because there've been a lot of really sort of encouraging triumphs. On the other hand, there have been some low points where you just kind of wonder, okay, Lord, is this really what you want us to be doing and how you want us to be moving forward and so on and so forth. And so, you know, my philosophy is just, you know, we learn and grow, and we're we're continually trying to learn and grow in our lives. And my sort of assertion through this this experience with the anti-human trafficking work is really we've sort of learned and grown through taking risks and through failing, okay? We don't always, I think those can be important tools to teach us in a lot of ways sort of how to move forward and how to be sensitive to God's leading and so on and so forth. And so the SAU Coalition on Human Trafficking really started a number of years ago. I think it's probably been 5 or 6 years ago, and one of the central components of that actually was a focus series that Spring Arbor University did based on modern-day slavery, okay? And so we had a number of events. I was working on a Fulbright application to study land issues in Uganda. I'd studied Swahili for 4 years at Michigan State and at University of Illinois Urbana-Champaign on a federal scholarship to do that. And really sort of like the Lord shut the door on the Fulbright, and there was a number of things starting up in terms of the human trafficking movement. And this was something that there's a number of catalysts that got this going. The first one for us was really the cross-cultural trip, okay? We had gone to Cambodia 1 year, and through a set of circumstances, we went into one of the red light districts to sort of learn a little bit more about how this place works and stuff like that. You know, obviously, it's a balance to make sure you're safe and to watch out for what's going on, but also we went through this red light district, and for the first time, somebody offered to sell me young girls, right? Which, you know, you can watch documentaries, you could read books, you could even, you know, drive by some of these areas, but until you sort of learn, okay, this is where the young girls are, this is how young they are, this is their age, these are the types of services they can do, and this is how much it costs, it didn't really seem that real to me. Does that make sense? And so as a result of that experience, which, you know, we were the number of students that were there, we sort of moving through that neighborhood, and then those students came back, and actually in a room like this, it might have even been this room, I don't remember, but they called me in one night, and they're like, hey, Norwood, you need to see that some of this stuff, you don't have to go to Cambodia to see this stuff. And I'm like, really? And first of all, I'm very self-conscious because we are at Spring Arbor University, and there are certain sort of stigmas against things that are quote-unquote dirty and whatever. But they were able to, on this monitor or a monitor like this, there were windows like that. I remember that because I was like, okay, who's going to see what we're looking at on the monitor right now? But to my surprise, you could actually go into, like you still can, you could go and there are chat rooms where guys would brag about visiting these massage parlors on 94 and in other parts of Michigan and about the types of services they offer. And you can go and you can pull that stuff up on these computers, quite surprisingly, without tripping a firewall. So, you know, I could go to a hockey trade site. You know, it's like March 1 is a trade deadline for the NHL. I don't know if any of you guys know that, but it's critical to this presentation. So I'm always like, okay, who's my team gonna get? Who's my team gonna get? But some of those, I can't go to those sites, but like these sites, we could perfectly access, you know, like all these sites where it's literally like, you know, like Backpage. We're doing some research on Backpage now, and Backpage literally sells people on the adult services site. And so the student started showing me these things, and I thought, wow, this is bizarre. This is pretty close to home. You know, the majority of students that go on the Cambodia cross-cultural trip, they don't necessarily feel like they're, you know, they're going to go back someday. And so some of them were like, how can we address human trafficking in our local communities? You know, it was a great question. So they called me in, and still, you know, as hard-headed as I am, you know, I've got to finish this dissertation on this topic and whatever. Well, then focus series comes along, okay? And, you know, we have some individuals that come out for focus series. You know, Kevin Austin, who's now the national leader of the Set Free movement, the Free Methodist Church, was a part of that and everything. And it was just a really interesting focus series because there were a number of topics on this issue of human trafficking. Is there any way we could free up that seat over there in the back? So there are a number of issues that the number of issues came up through this focus series, and there was a groundswell of support around the topic of human trafficking, both at the university and at the church. And I'm by groundswell, I mean like we would have meetings and you would have like 100 plus people coming, and they were really interested in the topic and so on and so forth. And so this was one of the things that sort of, you know, a number of these things start coming up. And before too long, I find my dissertation topic changing from these land right issues in Uganda, where I had applied for the Fulbright. The government pulls the Fulbright grant, and I'm left like, oh, maybe I should apply again, but what happens if I don't get it, kind of a thing. My advisor's saying, you know, you can go to Uganda for 3 months, come back and see your family for 2 weeks, and then go back for 3 months. And I'm like, yeah, no. So my kids are young, and that's just, it's not happening. So we change the focus of the dissertation topic, and then I start doing a great deal more research on this issue of human trafficking. And we start meeting as a group, largely around sort of what our first project was, which was looking at Asian massage parlors along the I-94 corridor, okay? And some of our early, students during that time, we did sort of controlled surveillance of massage parlors, okay? And what that means is we would pick a place that was safe, and we would just monitor what happened at these massage parlors. Like, who came, who left, when they came, when they left, license plates, paying particular attention. Now, you shouldn't do this, okay? If you're interested in learning more, then come and talk to me, and I can share what we know about this, but this isn't something we're currently doing anymore. We gathered a bunch of data and research, particularly with regard to those who work there, because we were really interested in sort of the networks that were in place, that the individuals who work there, where they travel to, and so on and so forth. And over time, we were able to, with the help of a couple of teams we coordinated with the church, we were able to monitor and to get an idea of the locations of where sort of like this, we were able to get an idea of how this network functioned, okay? And where it was located, like where people came and stuff like that. It's just interesting because people will bring supplies to these places, and like that's not just a normal thing. Like, you know, it's not normal for people to get massages at, you know, 12 and 1 a.m., right? So there's just a number of these different factors that went into this. We started presenting that research to mobilize political support, okay? And one of the things that happened along the way with this issue and with any issue that you folks might be interested in and that might be something like human trafficking, you may be interested in, you know, child abuse or domestic violence or some of these other social issues, one of the things that you have to realize is that the initial, like, this was sort of like there was a wave with this, okay? And everybody was interested and you get a lot of people interested. But over time, what happens is the emotion kind of stuff, it wears off. Okay, all the, you know, you got to fight injustice and rah, 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 and you get all upset and wound up about it. And it's like after a while that sort of wears off a little bit, right? It's like, have you ever been in a relationship over the first few months and it's like perfect? And then you finally get to know each other and you're like, wait, they're a human being. They have faults, just like I do, and so on and so forth. And then it really sort of comes down to like, okay, how are we gonna, is this something that's going to last or not? And it was the same way with this movement, okay? So it got down to where we, you know, we went from like over 100 people to 15 to 20 people to 10 to 15 people, but those were the people that were committed, okay? And so we were able to get a lot more work done with the smaller group that was committed to learning more than we necessarily were when nobody knew what was going on and what we were doing, right? Overtime. So that was, to some degree, that was a challenge, okay? It could have been easy to say, you know what, we don't have 100, 200 people coming to these meetings anymore. Yeah, this must be a sign from God that, you know, we shouldn't be addressing this issue of human trafficking. Well, if we know who God is and what his characteristics are and sort of that he stands on the side of the marginalized and the oppressed, then we know that that's not the case, right? And we know that this isn't the way things were meant to be, okay? And so, you know, that was one of our initial challenges. Once we began to present the research, some interesting things started happening. Politicians started taking notice. One of the things that we did as a result of our human trafficking class is we wrote letters and we called like crazy, okay? We called the prosecuting attorney's office, we called congressmen, we called everybody. And pretty soon, the congressman calls up and says, hey, can we do this forum, Congressman Wahlberg, can we do this forum at Spring Arbor on human trafficking? And we're like, gee, let us think. You know, let me think about it. Yeah, sure, we can. Well, it didn't work out as well as we thought. It was during exam week, because that's when it worked with his schedule. But we still had good turnout. We had the prosecuting attorney come out. We had the sheriff come out. We had Michigan State Police representation, stuff like that. Okay? Because the letters and the phone calls, in law we call this sort of like you draw blood a little bit. They weren't happy with us. Like, please stop calling us. We don't want to get any more letters. And it's like, okay, then, like, what are we going to do? Right? So there's a task force that gets formed. The congressman comes and does this talk several years ago at Spring Arbor. And this starts to be, this is what we call in sort of Social 100. This is where it's sort of transformed into a public issue. The other interesting thing that happens, and we were praying for this, the other interesting thing that happened was we had an individual on I don't know what you call these things. We gave a talk at one of the wards in Jackson, second ward, which is where some of the massage parlors are. And a gentleman gets on those comment boards. It's not like a blog, but it's like the comments after they post an article or about an event or whatever. There's these comments. And he says, I just want to let you know you're doing great work. And this is a horrible issue. And he makes some statements that where it's like, yeah, this is a little bit more than just like cheerleading. You know what I mean? And he comes back, and then the person who sort of directed the event reached out to him and said, well, there's some interesting comments that you made. You know, what's going on? Like, it seems like, you know more about this issue. Turns out, it's a former law enforcement officer, okay, in the Midwest. I'm going to be as general as I can because I want to protect his safety. But he's sort of like this former law enforcement officer who started, when he was young, started visiting massage parlors, fell for one of the women, and literally travels around the Midwest to follow her. And he offered, he knows the higher ups, he offered to buy her out, and they said, there's no way, can't buy her out, right? So like, that was pivotal for us because it was like, okay, we haven't been in these places, we've monitored them, we can monitor some of the online stuff, but like we need more evidence to show that this is an issue. We also had been touching base with a number of individuals sort of at this state and federal level, okay? One of the challenges for us, another challenge has been educating those on the front lines, okay? And so one of the things that we've noticed is that the average law enforcement officer, the average social service worker, they don't know what this issue is. It's a new issue. It's something that they're not sure about. Amongst a lot of law enforcement people, they still look at individuals that are in some of these areas as prostitutes. So there's this big dynamic between, well, no, they're there because they choose to be there. Because a typical cop is going to pick up a woman on solicitation all the time. There are areas in Jackson where that happens. Okay, in fact, after I graduated from Spring Arbor, I lived in downtown Jackson for a little while with some friends, and there was a woman in the neighborhood that went downtown and solicited, right? So for law enforcement, they're used to seeing solicitation. They're not as used to seeing or to understanding the idea that there's something like 80 to 85% of women soliciting sex work for a pimp. Pimps on average make $250,000-$300,000 a year tax-free, okay? So when you look at some of the research, there is I don't want to take away this element of human choice, this choice element, right? But at the same time, we've got to dig a little bit deeper than just booking people on solicitation charges if there's more going on up the food chain, right? And so one of the big struggles for us has been, how do we adequately prepare? How do we raise awareness? How do we train? And it's not just like us, like, okay, Norwood and this group of like juniors and seniors show up and train law enforcement, okay? It's how do we get the right people to the table to do the trainings, okay? Because if law enforcement can understand what trafficking is, it can build the appropriate networks for aftercare and prosecution and some of these other things, then you can start sort of turning the tide a little bit, right? Potential victims, trust, you've got to build trust. So one of the things that Dr. Hawthorne's working on right now with a couple of our students is doing a survey in Jackson County to gauge the level of trust that Jackson County citizens have for law enforcement, okay? Because if they don't trust law enforcement, they're not going to step forward and say, we're victims here, okay? Especially if normally these women are always viewed as what? Perpetrators or criminals, okay? So we've got to look at that a little bit deeper. We're trying to do the best we can to sort of move that conversation forward. But that's been another one of the challenges. One of the other sort of projects that we're working on is on backpage.com. We had two honors projects last year, Jess Mabry, who's now Jessica Kessler, and then Connor Shane, both did honors projects looking at backpage advertising amongst the I-94 and the I-75 corridors, okay? The Michigan is very unique in terms of human trafficking in the sense that we have a number of border crossings. We have extensive interstate systems. We've got 94 connects Chicago and Detroit, and you will find claims of human trafficking between those areas all the time. I could give you, you know, a number of examples in Jackson where older male befriends a young woman, they start dating, pretty soon she's over in Detroit being sold, okay? And it isn't just like, you know, overnight, but that happens frequently in Jackson, okay? And that's another thing, that's another one of the misperceptions that's a challenge is that like everybody thinks like, oh, trafficking, that happens over there, right? Oh, that's a Detroit thing, you know, Detroit. All the bad stuff happens in Detroit, right? Or that's overseas, right? That's something that happens, you know, in Asia, or that happens in Africa or Latin America or something. Folks, it happens here, okay? And it's really tough sometimes because you can't get over that initial sort of realization. I mean, I know, you know, when I started during the time I was in law school, I interned for a prosecuting attorney's office. And some of the things that go on in your community, you wouldn't believe. It's just, you don't have to deal with it, so you don't know. And so it's just sort of like it's hidden, right? So the Backpage study that we're doing, is really interesting because this is another phenomenon where we're like, okay, we can't prove that everyone posted on Backpage is being trafficked. But we know from literature and other cases that human trafficking does happen here. So an interesting thing happened last summer, okay? A former criminal justice major who's now going through law school, he's doing night school or weekends or something. He works over in Battle Creek at a juvenile detention center, okay? Or it's not a juvenile detention center. It's like he works in the juvenile justice system. So he works with at-risk youth, and he calls, and he says, Norwood, because I think we got a case of human trafficking. And I'm like, okay, I'm not asking you to give me specifics, but give me the hypotheticals. He says, all right. He says, got a couple of young girls. It was one daughter, one sister, okay? The daughter is being sort of pimped out by a boyfriend of the mom. And I said, okay, so how do you know this, whatever? Well, she came in and we started building this relationship with her, which is key, okay? Because you got to earn the trust of people, especially people in these circumstances, because they're not it's not going to be easy for them to trust people, okay? Because they've had that trust be sort of manipulated and sort of like used against them over and over again. Okay, so like in terms of the trust issue, they sort of build her trust in the juvie, okay? Or in the juvenile justice system there. She starts telling them about what's going on, okay? He calls me and says, we don't have a protocol about how to deal with these cases. We don't even know what to do. I said, all right. I said, you know what? He goes, can you come over and talk to me and a coworker? And I was like, you know, sure. So we set up this time. The coworker actually, it's funny how, you know, and you have these connections. You normally know people that know people. And this was one of these cases where, you know, it's smack dab in the middle of baseball season. They're from Homer. Her daughter plays softball all the time. So we're talking about sports. And then all of a sudden it's like, okay, you know, she knows somebody that I know in law enforcement over here that we've worked with before. And so I work with those two. And they said, okay, listen, this young woman is being advertised on Backpage. We know that her story is true because we can go on Backpage and that's her picture. Okay. So what do? They refer that to Battle Creek PD, which automatically I'm like, ooh, like, I don't know. Cause you have to develop a network of people that you know and trust that can work the case the way it should be worked, or else again, she's going to be the one collared for it and she's going to get thrown in jail and she's not going to want to say anything. Okay. One of the things that's been implemented, a diversion program, there's diversion programs. One of the major things that have been implemented in these cases is immediately when you have a victim of human trafficking, their first point of contact is a social worker that's received heavy training and trauma, not law enforcement. Okay? That social worker that's received the training and trauma can ask her questions and get her to open up and to get her to earn that trust in ways that law enforcement can't. Okay, now, when I talk to law enforcement about that in Jackson County, they get overly defensive, okay? Because who are you to tell them how to do their job? But really what the research shows is if you can develop that initial relationship with that victim, your chances of prosecuting those above the victim skyrocket because you've established that trust, okay? And so it's interesting, we've got to learn how to reshape these models. Not in a way to say, you know, law enforcement, you aren't doing your job. It's just that, like, there are a number of services that victim needs, okay, other than just to be sort of interviewed and grilled as to what the facts are and so on and so forth. It's a lot more complicated with victims of trauma, okay? They don't always get the facts right every single time, okay? You've got to work with them over a longer period of time to sort of build your case. You can't just sit down and do it, get the facts, and go and prosecute the case, okay? So the Backpage website research was interesting because we're able to say, okay, Battle Creek PD went in, okay? They investigated the case based on that Backpage ad, okay? And they're able to say, okay, yep, this is her. Okay, the story lines up. Then they're able to go and use their technology to track who posts the ad, you know, who's the one that's pimping her out and so on and so forth. They're able to bring charges against that individual, which is great. Okay? Which is great. And then we're also able to network with an organization in Grand Rapids that works with victims, especially minor victims of trafficking, which is called Manassa Project. Okay? And so we're able to sort of, like, I was able to then say, hey, Mark, what about this organization? He contacts the organization. It's not just that you secure the prosecution, but you get the appropriate aftercare for the victim. According to the Trafficking Victims Protection Act, those victims who are cooperative with prosecution, okay, of their trafficker can receive, they can receive benefits if they're U.S. citizens. If they're not U.S. citizens, they can expedite their process in terms of securing a T visa or a U visa, which will help protect them as opposed to sending them back to the country where they came from, which means they could get wrapped up in it all again, right? And so there's different ways to approach that too, okay? So the Backpage research, some of that research that we found, okay, was, I don't know if you heard about the Super Bowl connection to human trafficking the last couple of years, right? In Indy, then in Houston. One of the things that we wanted to study was to look at certain events and see if ads on Backpage correlated with those events. So last year we looked at a lot of big sporting events. We looked at large conferences, huge cultural events. and we tracked the posts. We did like a 6-month study, and we tracked the ads for 6 months. Might have been like 9 months, actually. 6 to 9 months. One of them, I think, was 6 months. One of them was 9 months. We tracked those ads to see which days, which events, and so on and so forth. We tracked those patterns to see what they looked like, okay? We had the two studies last year, and we're going to work on getting those published and present them at conferences and stuff like that. The Asian Massage Parlor research, we've already presented, and we're working on getting it published now. And so we're working on some of these things in terms of sort of like getting this research and this data out there. But in terms of, I talked a little bit before about the grassroots level sort of training and stuff like that, okay? We've been fortunate because at the state level, the Michigan State Legislature is now required that all helping professionals, so counselors, social workers, nurses, I've got dental hygienists that have emailed and want training, emergency room professional. I mean, just think about those who would come in contact with human trafficking victims, and also we have, through this, that free group here, Walt and Wanda Schultz have done extensive training in Jackson County, even in schools, okay? So J-High, Western, Lumen Christi, Northwest, and other Jackson County schools. Okay, Vandercook, Lake, they've done. Center, I think they've done. So there's a number of those sort of programs we're trying to put in play. The struggle now, okay, is over a number of years, we've had conversations with the local folks, right? We've met, Matt Osborne and I met a couple of times with housing inspectors. You guys know who housing inspectors are? They're the ones that have to go in and investigate, sort of see whether or not there are code violations. And so these folks are the eyes. I mean, they go into these places. Okay. Unfortunately, there's only like 15 or so in Jackson. But they get into some of these places. Okay. We talked with them 2 years ago, wanted to do a formalized training. Nothing ever really materialized. Okay. This year we've had conversations about, more conversations about that. And we've also sort of had verbal commitments that the police department, the sheriff's department, is open. The sheriff's department is really sort of difficult. The sheriff's interesting guy. And then the prosecuting attorneys as well are on board with it, because they're the initial ones that called a task force to meet and discuss the issue. One of the challenges, folks, and the risks is, Who gets the data, right? I mean, we've had Asian massage parlors in Jackson County for decades now. They've always been here, okay? So in the back of your mind, you're kind of thinking like, okay, like how do we approach this issue, right? If they've been here, okay, if they've existed for this long, and there are other venues for human trafficking in Jackson too. I mean, we have housing inspectors coming in saying, wow, this could have been human trafficking. We went into that Chinese restaurant, right? And they had bunk beds stacked up to the ceiling in the basement, and the people are living there. Or there's another ethnic Chinese restaurant in Jackson where literally one person will walk the people to and from work every day, right? And these things exist, okay? The housing inspectors say, well, what about that convenience store down there on whatever street? We found this family living in one room in the back, this Pakistani family. It's like, what do you do with that? Do you not ever report that? Do you think something's going wrong there? And it's just sort of, it's like frustrating. It's like there's no, but they don't, there's not always a mechanism, okay, to report it and stuff like that. So we want to be able to build this network, housing inspectors, law enforcement, social service personnel, so on and so forth, to be able to build that web and that network so that they can report it. Now, the difficult thing is the best way, and Deja and I were talking about this yesterday, the best estimates we can get in terms of the numbers of victims or prospective victims of human trafficking is that Polaris Project hotline, right? You guys have ever gone, and that's the first, I had a former student again that works at the Jackson County Juvie, again, another great. I know of cases of human trafficking that have gone through there, but not because the employees that work there, half of which are Spring Arbor grads, okay? The guy who runs it is a Spring Arbor grad. But yet, half the time, none of it gets reported, right? So we had a case, for example, just recently, a kid who's a criminal justice major again, like the guy in Battle Creek, calls me up, Norwood, it's on a Saturday. Well, he called me and I didn't pick it up because it was a weekend. I gotta have some sort of boundary sometimes. But then he texts me. He says, Norwood, listen, we got a case here. So I call him back, because it's emergency, right? Like, stop playing with my kids for a minute. Take a call. Call him up. I'm like, what's going on? He said, well, listen, generally, okay, is a young woman on the FBI missing persons list, 13 years old. Well, she was 13 years old and she left Jackson, left with an older boyfriend. Nobody's been able to find her since. She comes back at 15, 2 years later. He's like, I met her 2 years ago when she first came in. She's like, now she's in the wind, she's gone. She comes back. I'm talking to her, and he says, well, I asked her why she came back. She says, I miss my mom. So she's missing being a teenager, right? So she comes back, she's getting tired of things, right? You can't force people out of it. She comes back, she's getting tired of things. She sort of spills the story about what's going on. He said, what do we need to do? I said, you need to call that Polaris Project hotline. I'd met the guy who runs the task force out of Detroit area for minors, just like a week and a half before. I said, what'll happen? Polaris will get that claim. They'll bounce it to that task force. This FBI agent who runs this task force will pursue it. Sunday, he got a call. Monday, FBI was there, interviewed her, stopped the judge from releasing her, okay? And they were able to get aftercare for her and then to move on with the case, okay? It can happen. This stuff can happen. It's just, it can't always be at the federal level, right? We need buy-in from local folks, from the people at the juvie, from social workers, from police officers, okay? From teachers. And then the other thing is, folks, is moving forward, one of the challenges is, one of the things that has happened whenever, and this is something we need to do better at in terms of a way maybe in which we failed, but we need to keep exerted pressure on politicians, because that's when things happen, okay? That's initially when we drew blood with the folks here, okay? That's initially when we got a call from Congressman Wahlberg's office. That's initially when we received traction from the prosecuting attorney's office in terms of the task force. Well, recently, last fall, okay, Jackson College held a forum, right? Lee Hampton, who is, I think he's sort of like the equivalent of an OIR guy there. He's excellent. He called me up. He called me up over the summer. He said, Nora, we want to have an event, and everybody we talk to here says that you have to be there. And I'm like, okay. When do you want to have this? When do you want to do some of this stuff? And then we talked about it. It was great. It was collaboration. You know, it wasn't like we want to do this and we're going to do it. It's like, how do we do this to benefit the community? Which was terrific. Those are the types of partnerships we need to continue to build. We have this talk. Very well done. Very professional. Media's there. All kinds of stuff. Again, Congressman Wahlberg, prosecuting attorney, Michigan State Police, whomever's there. You know, and we're sitting on this panel. Derek Dobies, who's the vice mayor, who's been really, really great with some of this stuff too. And then just because we're all there, we start talking about things again. Start talking about this ordinance that we put together 3 years ago that hasn't been passed. Oh, we need to get that ordinance passed. And I'm just like, deep breaths. Yeah, we need to get this ordinance passed. We worked our butts off on it, and it's been sitting on your desk for 3 months, or excuse me, 3 years, and nothing's happened. And so it, you know, but I'm trying to play it cool. Trying to be calm. Yeah, it'd be really great to get that ordinance in. You know, how can we work together to do that? You know? Also, there was one of the FBI agents in the crowd, and I didn't recognize her because I hadn't seen her in a couple years. We all talk afterward, and all of a sudden this momentum picks up again. Okay? Before the end of the fall, they passed the ordinance. Okay? Before the end of the fall, we sit down, before Christmas break, we sit down in the mayor's office and talk about, you know, how we need to do these trainings and how we're going to do them at the end of January, right? Which was like a couple of weeks ago. I've been texting people, trying to get after people. It hasn't happened yet. But these are the challenges you face, right? When you deal with an issue like human trafficking, you deal with any sort of issue, and you deal with, I mean, these guys, they're busy people. They're doing a number of things for Jackson. I can't presume that human trafficking needs to be the top issue or whatever. You know what I mean? But like, one of the things I want to sort of leave you all with is, as we talk through this sort of this risk and failure thing, I don't know if you're going to be able to realize your dreams unless you take risks. You know what I mean? If somebody told me when I was in your seat, like when I was a college sophomore, college junior, hey, you're going to be back at Spring Arbor someday addressing this issue of human trafficking at the state level, right? I'd be like, what are you talking about? Right? Okay? God has such great plans for each one of you, right? Plans that you can't, like, I was a planner. I'm structured to a fault, okay? And I had everything figured out. You know, what I was going to do with my life, how it was going to work out. And the Lord took me in a different direction, but it's much beyond, much further beyond what I could ever imagine it would be. And it's been great. I've been really inspired by that. So if you don't start to take those risks, if we hadn't said a number of years ago, you know, with the group of juniors and seniors, yeah, let's try doing a conference. Would this ever have happened? Like, I don't know. So you got to learn to take risks. And you've also got to learn and you've got to understand the importance of failure. Now, that doesn't mean go out and just try and screw up all the time. You know what I mean? Do your best. Do what you want to do professionally and excellently. Okay? But understand that there are times that you're going to fail. And I talk to my kids about this with sports all the time. I think, like, you don't learn things without first coming up short sometimes. Okay? And I think that failure can teach you a great deal as long as you allow it to be a positive thing. Does that make sense? Allow it to be a positive thing in your life. Okay? One of the best pieces of advice I ever got, Dr. Baldwin, Bruce Baldwin over in the science department, right? I think he's chemistry. One of the best pieces of advice during my dissertation process, which was one of the hardest things I've ever done, was it isn't always the people who are the smartest to get through that process. It's the people who refuse to quit. And I'll tell you what, like, I was brought up, you don't quit. You keep working hard, you keep moving forward. You use your failures to motivate yourself. And I'll tell you this, God is faithful and God is just, all right? So we know who comes out ahead in this, right? We know who comes out ahead in this. And so one of the things that I've found is that after some of the lowest valleys, okay, the Lord will bring you out of those, and you'll get, I mean, whenever we've had a setback, after a week, 2 weeks, a month, something else pops up, and it's like, wow, I never saw that coming. So, like, understand that the path you're supposed to take isn't always the one you think you've got mapped out 100%. And that the Lord has an even better path picked out for you and a better sort of way forward. I mean, so this year, Larry Pfaff, I don't know if you guys know Larry Pfaff in the Department of Psychology. What a character, that guy. He is one of the wisest guys I know, and I do mean that both ways. He's a very wise, smart individual I've learned a great deal from. He's retiring this year, and I'm going to really miss him. On the other hand, he makes some of the wisest jokes that I've ever seen in my life. And so, like, that's what I mean, like, he's wise in both ways, right? Excellent guy. Pfaff connects me with someone at the state level who's looking to do trainings on human trafficking because of the state law, okay? Because of the state law, okay? And so now, like, I'm fortunate to network with survivors, with Manasseh, to do these trainings for like hundreds of people across the state who are on the front lines, to say if you suspect that someone may be this victim of human trafficking, here's how you can approach that situation. Okay, here's what to look for, and by the way, you know, here's this survivor who's gone through it that can give you all sorts of good counsel as to what it's like to feel like you're a victim, right, and to not want help, right. Because, you know, you don't want to let people in or trust people. And also Manasseh Project, who does great work with minor victims of human trafficking. So it's been neat. You know, we're gonna be at Eastern Michigan on Friday. Next month we're going to Central Michigan University, and then we're going to do a dental hygienist one in March. We've got Western Michigan. We've got Lansing. Or what is it, Great Lakes Christian College in Lansing? Is that Great Lakes? Yeah, if that's what it's called. The one in Lansing. We're going to be up in Traverse and do a lot of these different trainings for folks, Ann Arbor, and it's going to allow us to equip those frontline folks. But the way forward, people, is I'm sort of, you know, this is sort of a work in progress. Honestly, the best sort of reports I've received from people are from former students, honestly, who have probably heard way too much about this issue of human trafficking, but they go out and they work in the field and they're on the front lines. I can equip people, okay? I know way too much probably, you know? But many of you will be out on those front lines. And I'm not saying like, oh, you gotta drop everything and go do human trafficking work, but the more you know about these issues, the more you can reach out and serve and sort of like assist people that you're gonna come in contact with, okay? And I'm always here as a resource, but I've been thankful and blessed by the fact that some of our grads have been like, Norwood, what about this? What about that? You know, and we have grads now that are going to law school and wanna do this with the rest of their lives. We got grads working in NGOs, you know, working on these issues. But the way forward to me is trying to continue to build those partnerships, okay? I love that I can call Lee at Jackson College and talk about how we can do a couple of events next October to continue to move this conversation forward and to say, how can we support each other? How can we join forces? You know, I'll talk to Amber McKee from the Set Free group. I talked to Kevin Austin, the national guy, yesterday. I've got a contact in the social work department at Eastern Michigan. You know, we've got some contacts at Calvin College. Just sent a group of 16 people there for their Faith and International Development Conference. It's building those networks. And the current challenge and sort of prayer moving forward is it's great to go to all these universities, but we've got to build this in Jackson, okay? Got to build this in Jackson. And the mayor and the vice mayor and others, city manager, they want to move forward with these issues in terms of how do we address this? But at the same time, it's just keeping that pressure on. So they know that we're, you know, that we're aware of this and that we want something to change and to happen. Let me just end real quick, you guys, with just the information here. One of our challenges last year, we didn't get the conference up and going like we needed to. The 3 years before that, we were going, we were fine. This year, this past October, we had to cancel it because we didn't have enough people signed up, okay? And so what we want to do is we want to relaunch this, okay, and have our fourth annual conference on human trafficking on this date, okay, Saturday, October 14th. We're very interested in any way that we can. We're very interested in sort of like having, if you guys are interested in this issue, it's, you know, our cost, it's pretty affordable. It's like $25, okay, if you can come as a student. You know, if for some reason you can't pay, then just contact me or somebody with the team, and we'll figure out a way to get you there and to take care of that, okay? And so, like, when we look at some of this stuff, you guys, this is all the information. If you want to keep getting involved with issues like this, we also meet Tuesday nights at 9:30, right over in this conference room. We met last night, 9:30 till about 11, sort of working on some of these issues with human trafficking in our community. Another project we do, and then if you guys have any questions, you can ask. Another project we're doing too that we could use help with is that we're partnering with the Michigan Abolitionist Project, okay, which is in the greater Metro Detroit area, and we're monitoring rest stops, okay? They've got, if you guys have gone in these rest stops locally, you see they have these stop things, and they have tabs where you can call to get assistance. Yeah, Blake, you helped out yesterday, right? We had some, we're going and monitoring those to see how many people take those little slips. It's almost like, have you ever seen like somebody selling a book and it has like those little dog ears or those tabs and you take it? It's kind of like that, okay? So we're working on a project, three rest stops, right here by Deering, way out by Grass Lake, and one up on North 127, okay? So let me pause now, and otherwise I'll just keep talking. What sorts of questions or comments or things like that do you all have as far as this topic goes and stuff? What, any questions? Dr. White, yeah.
On a scale of 1 to 10,
yep.
How important is it to shut down the place at 145?
Okay, the place on 145, yeah, that's the one actually that I know the most about. On a scale of 1 to 10, I think that I'd want to do something that would address all of, we have four. In fact, I think there's a fifth now that just opened. right next to one of the other ones. So in terms of massage parlors, I'd like to continue to put in place regulations or to raise awareness around some of these issues that regard with regard to those, to put pressure on them, okay? The city council, they could pass ordinances that regulate the heck out of these places, that make it so that it's not profitable to be here, okay? We could look at massage licensure. We could look at a lot of these different things. We just need the momentum from several different sectors that can enforce those things. Does that make sense? So on a scale of 1 to 10, to me, it'd be like a 10, but it doesn't matter what, if it's a 10 to me, it matters what's a priority to them. Those who are in power to be able to do something about it, right?
I mean, what if you have tickets that surround
the
thing for a month?
Yeah, I think that, I think the hard thing with that is just that I think that whatever we do, if we have them shut down, they'll move. But at least you've created a model that you can replicate to move to those other places too. The picketing thing, the only thing I'm concerned about is I don't want those that are in the massage parlors to feel like they can't reach out, that they can't testify or speak out against what's going on. So I don't want them to perceive that, okay, now all these people are angry at them because they're there or something like that. We need to figure out ways that we can build those relationships and partnerships and build that trust if we can. I think the picketing thing can just be, it can come across in the wrong way, especially if you've got the same groups that are always sort of picketing things. You know, I want people in those places to feel like they have somebody to talk to about things, as opposed to, you know, that's wrong and that's bad and that's dirty kind of stuff, right? But the signs, sir, the signs are a big thing that we need to address, okay? And so if you got ideas about that, then I'd be more than happy to talk. So the signs are a big deal. Yep. Well, yeah, because I mean, you're getting a lot of these folks that they're moving from place to place. A lot of these folks, some of them come from the community. Okay, like I could get even really, really close to your point of reference in Spring Arbor about people that go to these places. Okay, in fact, like I remember, we used to have a business professor who bought her husband a free massage as a gift at a massage parlor. Yeah, announced it to the class. Some of our students that were working on this issue, like had a real hard time not laughing out loud at the fact that that was seen as like a nice massage place. But anyway, and there's also people we've heard that frequent those places that are a little bit closer to home. So I just, we got to be careful about how we do some of that stuff and how we promote it. As far as the signs, though, those are the places. I mean, the signs are the places where they're also advertised on Backpage. At least one of them, Tokyo spot on town is. But the signs, I mean, if you could take down the signs, then maybe you get less traffic, interstate traffic that stops off at these places too. Because 145 is like right there. It's got a rundown Colonial Inn, which I almost guarantee there's overlap there. And then that gas station. The gas station that used to be there plowed that place in the wintertime, which was always interesting to me, right? So you often find these places really close to the interstate. The ones downtown are different. The ones downtown, they're not as easily accessible from the interstate. So there are a number of those too. The only other thing, let me say one more thing, you guys, and then you're free to go. I don't want to harp on adult establishment places, okay? But we've also had folks that have done ministry in strip clubs. And there's also extensive data with regard to strip clubs. Not every woman that works there has been trafficked. But there are also cases there where we have had victims that have been trafficked. Okay? And those networks are really interesting as well. So it's another venue with the ethnic restaurants, the massage parlors, where you can find this too. You guys go out and learn more. Okay, if you wanna become involved, 9:30 Tuesday nights, right over here in the conference room. Love to have you. Thank you all for coming. Okay.